Mass here on EWTN. EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
Family, a prayer that we pray together is a powerful prayer. So please pray together with me our EWTN family prayer. Today we pray for those who have left the church. Lord Jesus Christ, Good Shepherd, we praise you. You founded the church on the foundation of the apostles and promised that the gates of hell would never prevail against her. Bring those who have left the faith back into the fold of your Catholic Church. Give them the grace of conversion from sin. Stir into flame the gift of the Holy Spirit within them, and restore to your prodigal children their lost dignity. Lord Jesus, mercy. Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done.
through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Peacemakers are to be called your children. Grant, we pray, that we may work without ceasing to establish that justice which alone ensures true and lasting peace. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, every high priest is taken from among men and made their representative before God to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal patiently with the ignorant and erring, for he himself is beset by weakness. And so, for this reason, he must make sin offerings for himself as well as for the people. No one takes this honor upon himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. In the same way, it was not Christ who glorified himself in becoming high priest, but rather the one who said to him, "You are my son, this day I have begotten you." Just as he says in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days when he was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who is able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. Verbum Domini.
Deo gratias.
You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek.
You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek.
The Lord said to my Lord, "Sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool."
You are a priest forever.
The scepter of your power, the Lord will stretch forth from Zion. Rule in the midst of your enemies.
You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek.
Yours is princely power in the day of your birth, in holy splendor. Before the day star, like the dew, I have begotten you.
You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek.
The Lord has sworn, and he will not repent. You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek.
You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek.
Deus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Marcum.
Gloria tibi, Domine.
The disciples of John and of the Pharisees were accustomed to fast. People came to Jesus and objected, "Why do the disciples of John and the disciples of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast?" Jesus answered them, "Can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. But the days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast on that day. No one sews a piece of unshrunken cloth on an old cloak. If he does, its fullness pulls away the new from the old, and the tear gets worse. Likewise, no one pours new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and both the wine and the skins are ruined. Rather, new wine is poured into fresh wineskins." Verbum Domini.
Laus tibi, Christe.
This past Saturday here in Birmingham, we had the March for Life Birmingham, which began at Brother Brian Park, downtown Birmingham. And Jim Pinto, EWTN personality, is the one who organizes this event. He said that he was asked by the officials, "Do you want to permit pro-choice people to be there as well?" He had the option. He said, "Yes, allow them to be there as long as they're respectful." So, of course, a larger gathering were the people supporting life, the dignity of all human life. But there was a contingent of those with their pro-choice signs and different slogans that they have. And what Jim did, and he addressed them actually during the course of the rally that was going on before the march, is that he addressed them and he said, "We welcome you, we are grateful for your lives. We thank you that you have been respectful during this rally." He said, "I was once as you are. I was pro-choice. But things happen in our lives that help us to see things differently." And something that they did that I thought was really effective is that there were two women who were there who were with child. One was 18 weeks along, another was 21 weeks along. And now with technology, they have monitors that actually you can hear the heartbeat of that child at that stage of development. And so they had that monitor on the women, and each one of them, they put it over the loudspeaker system. And so you could hear, choo, 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 choo. You hear this heartbeat of this child, first of one and then of the other. Choo, 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 choo. Kind of cuts through all of the rhetoric. And it really says, you know, here is a human life. There's a heartbeat here. We often define the end of life, well, is it our heartbeat? No, there's no heartbeat. Well, then there's death. If there's a heartbeat, then it means there's a human life there. Brother John Therese, who was with us, he was listening to a conversation that some pro-life people were having with the people on the pro-choice side. And one of the young women on that pro-choice side said, "We're not talking about morality here, we're talking about legislation." As if there's supposed to be a difference between morality and our laws. And you see, today in the United States, we have a civil holiday of Martin Luther King Jr., who was a great civil rights activist fighting for the recognition of the dignity of all human people, that a man should not be judged by the color of his skin, but by the content of his character. It's a wonderful quotation of Martin Luther King Jr. And he actually spent time in a Birmingham jail here for his activities. You know, Mother Angelica was well aware of these, what was going on with the civil rights movement here in the South, up in Ohio. And that was one of the reasons why she wanted to found this monastery here in Alabama, because this was kind of a heart of the civil rights activity that was going on. She wanted to pray that all people would be recognized for their human dignity. Whatever stage of life, we could say, whatever the color of their skin, that it's a God-given right that we have. But interestingly, Martin Luther King Jr., in his time in the Birmingham jail here, he wrote a letter that's well known. It was on April 16th, 1963. And Dr. David Anders, who's one of our radio show personalities, he has a very popular program called A Call to Communion. It's a lot of apologetics defending the Christian faith and morality and so on. But he wrote a couple of articles about some of the things that Martin Luther King Jr. said in that letter in a Birmingham jail. He said that he was having a conversation with a friend of his who's an ethics professor at a secular university, and his views as a Catholic are not well received by the administration and often by the students. So he was asking David, well, how can I get across to the students that there is a right and a wrong in a culture that says there is no right or wrong? It's just everyone's own opinion, it's their feelings, it's what they want. It's all reduced to the human will. What is it that you want? There's no greater, you know, moral code or law that we're all under. So this professor who teaches ethics in the secular university is asking David, how can I get this across in a way that's not going to get the administration on my back and so on? And David answered him, well, why don't you teach about what Martin Luther King Jr. said? And this professor said, well, my class just finished reading that letter from the Birmingham jail. And it was in that letter, actually, that King brings out a distinction between natural law and man-made laws. And he actually quotes St. Augustine and St. Thomas Aquinas, Martin Buber, a Jewish philosopher, and other Protestant philosophers as well. But he quotes St. Augustine in this letter from a Birmingham jail. You can easily find it on the internet if you want to read it. He quotes St. Augustine, who wrote, "An unjust law is no law at all." And then King goes further on to quote St. Thomas Aquinas. "A just law is a man-made code that squares with the moral law or the law of God. An unjust law is a code that is out of harmony with the moral law." And directly from King's letter, to put it in terms of St. Thomas Aquinas, "An unjust law is a human law that is not rooted in eternal law and natural law." And David was saying that one of the greatest threats in Western society today is this loss of the sense of the natural law, the way things are, the moral way that we have been made, what God's plan is for his creation. And so we see all of these different movements, and I have these rights to act contrary to my own nature, or to our own nature as a people or as a society, or to take the life of one who even has a heartbeat in the womb. That's an unjust law because it doesn't accord with the higher natural moral law. And so this is something that Martin Luther King Jr. was well aware of and that he refers to, that we have to understand that there is this higher law to which all other laws must be subject, that a ruler has to see that he himself is under authority. Otherwise, he can become this terrible dictator. And King brings out in this letter that in Hitler, if you mistreated the Jews, that was legal for you to do that. But that was an unjust law. It wasn't in accord with the dignity of the humanity of the Jewish people. And so this is the whole pro-life movement as well. And in fact, his niece is part of this movement, Dr. King's niece, with the Priests for Life. Because this is a civil rights movement, really, of our day, as well as for all people. We know the tensions that are going on in our own country. And I'd like to read a couple of quotations. You know, he is often quoted, and he has some remarkably clear words that really speak to us, I think, Martin Luther King Jr. And just a couple of his quotes that I found especially and that are often quoted. This was one that he said when he received the Nobel Peace Prize on December 10th, 1964. I believe that unarmed truth and unconditional love will have the final word in reality. That is why right, temporarily defeated, is stronger than evil triumphant. Pope John Paul and Pope Benedict likewise said, evil will not have the final word. That's what the resurrection proclaims to us. Yes, as Dr. King brought out, right may be temporarily defeated, but ultimately that's the way we're made. That's the moral truth. We're made for this love. And to live differently than that, or even if evil should triumph for a time, it's temporary. Because truth is always stronger than evil triumphant. He also said in a speech in Detroit in 63, there are some things so dear, some things so precious, some things so eternally true, that they are worth dying for. And I submit to you that if a man has not discovered something that he will die for, he isn't fit to live. You see, there has to be something greater than our own self and our own whims and our own desires. That's much of what these cry for rights. And yes, all people have to have the right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, as our founding fathers said. But freedom doesn't mean just unrestrained license to do whatever and say whatever we want to do or say. Freedom has with it responsibility. We have a responsibility to do what is right. Yes, pro-choice, but you have the obligation to choose what is right, what is morally good, what is in accord with the natural law, the way that we are made, with God's law. From his letter from a Birmingham jail, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. The ultimate measure, this is from his book, Strength to Love, the ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at times of challenge and controversy. The true neighbor will risk his position, his prestige, and even his life for the welfare of others. One that especially, this is the first time I read it this morning. He said, we all have the drum major instinct. This was in a sermon that he gave one time. We all have the drum major instinct. We all want to be important, to surpass others, to achieve distinction, to lead the parade. And the great issue of life is to harness the drum major instinct. It is a good instinct if you don't distort it and pervert it. Don't give it up, he says. Keep feeling the need for being important. Keep feeling the need for being first, but I want you to be first in love. I want you to be first in moral excellence. I want you to be first in generosity. It was in 2010, I received a letter from a dear lady in Florida. She told me that she was 81 years old and that she had written to Dr. King during the marches when they were going on. And she wrote, and I still kept the letter, she said, I told him that if he wanted to win the hearts of people, that the rosary was the best way. And I followed it up with a request that I would teach his people how to make them. And then she received a personal letter back from him, and she said, would you like it? I said, yes. So here's the original, a letter from Dr. King to her about her suggestion that he would pray the rosary, that she would even have teach the people how to make the rosary for the success of winning the hearts of people about the dignity of all human people. And he begins the letter by saying, you know, it took him some time to respond to this letter because he gets so much correspondence. This was September 23rd, 1964. He wrote this letter. But he wanted to give this letter his own personal attention. He said, I appreciate very much your thoughtfulness in my behalf. The rosary has proven to be very helpful. Your letter warmed my heart and gave me new determination. Let us continue to work and pray together for a better world. Sincerely yours, Martin Luther King, Jr. So my brothers and sisters, we know that as Dr. Anders brought home, that in today's world there's often people don't understand that there is a way that we are to live. That's going to lead to our flourishing as individuals, as families, as society. There's a natural law, there's a moral law, there's a way that we are made. And to live in correspondence with that leads to our flourishing. You know, in the Old Testament, or the Israelite people, they were the one people of the ancient people that was given a moral code. And they were told that this would, the other nations would say, how wise this people is. How wise we are when we live in accord with the natural, the moral law. That misled young lady said, we're not talking about, you know, legislation. We're not talking about morality. We're talking about legislation. Well, should our laws reflect what is morally good? Of course they should. And a just law is one that reflects that moral code. So let us return to our Judeo-Christian heritage, which will lead us to our flourishing. Praise, honor, and glory be to the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as we turn to Him and humbly pray.
That our Holy Father may be blessed by the Mother of God with graces of humility and faith, and that like Mary, He may magnify the Lord and rejoice in our Savior. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the vocations God is giving to our youth may be fostered and supported by their families and friends, and that they may be imbued with total dedication to God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the special needs and intentions of the EWTN employees and of their families, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have gone before us in faith, that through the intercession of Mary, Gate of Heaven, they may soon enter into the embrace of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit forever. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray, too, for alleviation of the racial tensions in our own country and throughout the world, and also for the recognition of the dignity of every human person, from conception to natural death. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
God, source of all good, hear our prayer, inspire us with good intentions, and help us to fulfill them through Christ our Lord. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord
May the saving sacrifice of your Son, the King of Peace, offered under sacramental signs that signify peace and unity, strengthen, we pray, O Lord, concord among all your children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, in him you have been pleased to renew all things, giving us all a share in his fullness. For though he was in the form of God, he emptied himself, and by the blood of his cross brought peace to all creation. Therefore he has been exalted above all things, and to all who obey him has become the source of eternal salvation. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, 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 Dominus Deus Salvator, benedictus celi et terra, gloria tua.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mysterium fidei. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Robert our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God.
For those who cannot now receive Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, we offer the following prayer. O Jesus, thou hast given us in the Holy Eucharist thy body and blood to be our spiritual nourishment, through which we may have life everlasting. Would that I were able to receive thee this day in Holy Communion. I desire with all my heart to receive the living bread which comes down from heaven. O Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst enter under my roof. Say but the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let me taste at least the sweetness of a spiritual communion. Come to me, Jesus, my Lord, my Master. Come and refresh my soul. Strengthen me, that in union with thee I may do perfectly the Heavenly Father's will. Let me never be separated from thee by sin. Soul of Jesus, sanctify me. Body of Jesus, save me. Blood of Jesus, wash me. Water out of the side of Jesus, purify me. Passion of Jesus, comfort me. O good Jesus, hear me. Hide me within thy sacred wounds. O Sacred Heart of Jesus, receive me. O Immaculate Heart of Mary, plead for me and love me. Amen.
Inter nos ut olivas, et virtutis.
Let us pray. Bestow on us, we pray, O Lord, the spirit of charity, so that sustained by the body and blood of your only begotten Son, we may be effective in nurturing among all the peace that he has left us, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et spiritu.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite mihi est.
Years ago, a good friend texted me from my ride, "Please pray for our church, where all the people are held captive by terrorists." A couple hours later, she texted me again, "Lord have mercy, they killed everyone, including the children." That same Sunday, I went to Mass, so grateful to God I didn't have to worry about getting killed. And there was a kid in the back pew playing video games the whole time. It really struck me, just 7,000 miles away from us, a whole church load of people had given their lives to be where he was. What did they see that he was missing? You know, for the past few thousand years, since the birth of the church, Catholics have risked their lives just to be at Mass. Beautiful, ornate cathedrals have been built because of what happens inside those cathedrals at Mass. And I just joined the Pope and tens of thousands of Catholics in procession behind the Eucharist because of what happens at Mass. These people seeing at Mass. If you're not seeing it, you're missing something pretty amazing.
Hello friends, I'm Father Wade Menezes. Welcome to another segment of The Crux of the Matter. The Second Vatican Council has much to say about the presence of Jesus Christ in the liturgy. For example, the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy tells us that Christ is always present in His Church, especially in her liturgical celebrations. He is present in the sacrifice of the Mass, not only in the person of His minister, but especially under the Eucharistic species. By His power, He is present also in the sacraments. He is present in His Word, since it is He Himself who speaks when the Holy Scriptures are read in the Church. He is present, lastly, when the Church prays and sings, for He promised, "Where two or three are gathered together in My name, there I am in the midst of them." Paragraph number 1374 of the Catechism of the Catholic Church states beautifully, "The mode of Christ's presence under the Eucharistic species is unique. It raises the Eucharist above all the sacraments as the perfection of the spiritual life and the end to which all the other sacraments tend. In the most blessed sacrament of the Eucharist, the body and blood, together with the soul and divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ, and therefore the whole Christ, is truly, really, and substantially contained." The Catechism continues, "This presence is called real, by which is not intended to exclude the other types of presence, as if they could not be real too, but because it is presence in the fullest sense, that is to say, it is a substantial presence by which Christ, God and man, makes Himself wholly and entirely present. In other words, friends, whereas the other six sacraments effect what they signify, the Eucharist is what it signifies, namely, Christ Himself, really, truly, and substantially present in His body, blood, soul, and divinity. And that's the crux of the matter. God bless you."
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic. The following is an encore presentation of The Journey Home.
To The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodow, your host. Tonight is an episode of The Journey Home in which I've invited back a former guest. In fact, we were just talking, it's been more than 15 years since Ken Hensley joined me on the program. He's a former Baptist minister. Now he does work actually for the Coming Home Network, so it's good to have him here. But one of the reasons I like to invite former guests back is that one of the things we find out when we we have to condense our journey into this little hour, mm-hmm. or maybe half hour, to leave time for other questions. And then years later, we think, well, there's something I didn't say, or that maybe the more important thing is that over the years, the Holy Spirit helps us look back and reappreciate things that happened in our journey that opened our hearts to the walk with Jesus Christ in the church that we didn't even recognize early on. So, Ken, welcome to the journey home. Welcome back to the